हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय चैनल। दिस वीडियो इज़ गोइंग टू बी ऑन ऑर्किड पॉट्स, मीडिया एंड फर्टिलाइजर्स एंड ऑल्सो वेरियस अदर थिंग्स दैट वी नीड वाइल ग्रोइंग ऑर्किड्स एट होम्स। आई विल ट्राई टू फोकस ऑन द इकोनॉमिक एंड द इजीली अवेलेबल ऑप्शंस व्हाट आई यूज वाइल ग्रोइंग ऑर्किड्स। So to begin with, the cheapest and easiest option would be to simply tie the orchids to a tree if you have one in your compound. This will in fact be the closest possible way in which orchids grow in nature. Now most of the orchids they will do fine in this method of growing. However, it may be problematic in some seasons. We are at nature's mercy almost all the time. If it rains continuously for days together, then the orchid may face crown rot and other leaf spotting and other issues. Also, during extreme heat and extreme cold, if you live in extreme type of climate, then we can't move our orchids indoors and we have to leave them there. So in my opinion, the next best option will be mounting your orchids on a piece of wood, rock or any inert surface with some water retentive media like moss or coco coir. So this way we will have the independence or the scope of moving our orchids indoors, outdoors or any place of our choice. However, for beginners, mounting may not be that simple. Mounted orchids do need higher frequency of watering and fertilization compared to their potted counterparts, so one has to be committed for the same. I definitely prefer mounting my orchids over potting because it is more natural. Problems associated with overwatering is drastically reduced and it's quite inexpensive. I can mount on almost anything that I find lying around at my home, my garden, and it looks nice and quite interesting. Plus it saves a lot of space. In a small space we can have many number of orchids. We can simply hang them. You can check my videos on how I mount my orchids and how I care for them for a better understanding. Link is provided in the description box as well as in the info card over here. Now next best option is growing our orchids in pots, which most of us do. Now two types of pots are widely available, the plastic ones and the terracotta ones. An average 4 inch net plastic pot, it will cost somewhere around 10 to 15 rupees. There are slightly costlier options, these type of pots which cost around 20-25 rupees. However, they are not durable. They can last for around 2-3 years and after that they start cracking and getting damaged. If you don't have access to these pots, you can definitely make one from a regular plastic pot by making extra holes on the sides or the bottom, and so that you can let the orchid roots to breathe in them. They need good air circulation. If they don't get adequate ventilation, they will suffocate and rot. Most of the orchids are epiphytic. They need a lot of air circulation around their roots. We should always keep that in our mind. If I'm using plastic pots, then I prefer these type of pots. You can see what's going on inside. There are so many slits and it's transparent, so you can have a good look inside. One can assess the condition of the roots. Also, we can get an idea when to water, if the media is wet or it's dry, whether or not it's decomposing or not. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of plastic pots. Now coming to terracotta pots, they don't come cheap online. Best is if we can procure them from local markets. The ones that I have used here, it cost me 60 rupees per piece. You can use the plain terracotta ones also with just a few drainage holes at the bottom. The advantages here are it's highly porous, so it provides good air circulation around the roots. It's aesthetically pleasing and durable, and they keep the orchid roots cool. So for those of us living in tropics, terracotta pots definitely are a better option than plastic pots. However, the only problem is that the roots of the orchids, they tend to cling to the terracotta pot, and while repotting that might be a problem and some roots may get damaged.
However, we can use only inorganic media like brick pieces or charcoal. Then we can simply put the whole thing, including the pot, in a slightly larger pot, or we can simply up-pot the whole thing without actually having to remove the orchid from its pot and then repotting in another pot. So in this way, the roots can be saved. To media, for most of my orchids I use charcoal pieces, broken brick pieces, styrofoam, and for orchids with finer roots like oncidiums I use the same but in smaller bits, like the size of the charcoal, the size of the brick piece, the size of the styrofoam pieces, they will be quite smaller and less chunkier than that I use for my other orchids. I also add a little layer of sphagnum moss on the top if I am planting a completely rootless orchid, so that some it will provide more moisture towards the top and it will promote root growth. So this type of clean white long strand moss, it's not easily available in India. I used to get mine through Amazon earlier, and what we get here easily is this type of green moss, and it's not very water retentive as the previous one, but it's not bad either, and it's much cheaper than white clean long stranded moss. Another great cheap and easily available alternative is coconut coir. Not husk, but the coir, the coconut fiber. I don't like husk because it stays soggy and it degenerates very fast. However, I'm a fan of coir because coir is the washed product of husk. After all the cocoa peat is removed from it, this is what is left, and it is quite durable and it's somewhat water retentive. And so I feel it's a good option. It's a great alternative to sphagnum moss for those of us who live in tropic and where coconuts and coconut products are easily available. Now if you live somewhere where your climate is very dry, you will definitely have to add a water retentive media like moss or cocoa coir to your potting mix. I don't use bark because it's quite expensive, and if it and it breaks down in 2 to 3 years depending on how fine or coarse it is. After 2 3 years we will have to repot the orchid, and once it starts breaking down, it will use up a lot of nitrogen in the media, so the orchid will get lesser and lesser amount of nutrients and will have its a whole array of problems on its own. So many of the growers who live in cooler climates, in temperate zones where the humidity and the heat is less, for them bark works great, and I have a few friends who use bark without any problem. But for me, I live in the hot tropical climate, so bark tends to degenerate quite rapidly, and I prefer using a media that won't degrade or decompose very easily and will last for at least 4 to 5 years without any problem. The charcoal that I use is wood charcoal, horticultural variety of wood charcoal. You can even prepare it at home. These are the brick pieces that I use, also some bits of broken clay pot pieces. And as I have a little leka with me from my earlier semi-hydroponic setup, so I have started using it in my mix as well. Leka is nothing but expanded clay pellets. It's quite lightweight, and it has some amount of water retentive capacity. So I feel it can be easily mixed along with charcoal and other inorganic media, and it won't decompose fast as other organic options like bark or moss. Next, what we need is stakes, be it bamboo stakes or barbecue skewers or any stick, plastic or floral wires, anything. We need to make sure that the orchid is stable in its pot. You can watch my repotting videos to know in details how I use these. I tell in almost all my videos that an unstable orchid will never root easily, and to make it stable, we can't plant it too deep in the pot, it will start rotting. So it's always wise to use a stake. This way, not only the plant will be stable, but we can also adjust the height, like above what level the orchid will sit on the media. Not too deep
we can make the orchid sit just on top of the media. Problem with wooden stakes is that they will start rotting after some time, after a few months time, when they are left too long in the pots, or if the pot it stays constantly moist. So one simple technique that we can do before using them is that by applying varnish on them, or by simply using insulation tape or any duct tape over them, we can simply wrap it over them to make it waterproof. And once the orchid is stable, we can simply remove the stake after 2 to 3 months. Next is quite obvious one. We need a good source of water. It shouldn't be hard water. You can use tap water if your water is not hard water, or you can use RO water, distilled water, or rain water for your orchids. Now coming to rain water, it is definitely a good option. If you can store and collect rain water, and you can give your orchids rain water all year round, then it's quite good. The orchids will simply love it. If not, then at least during the rainy season, try to give your orchid roots some rain water. They'll love it. The problem with rain water is that it has very less buffering capacity. So it won't resist the changes in pH that much, and it always requires a fertilizer that will produce slightly acidic condition around the roots. A calcium magnesium fertilizer which gives calcium and magnesium will work best with this form of pure water or rain water. So next best option is definitely tap water, because it's easily available, it's cheap. But if your supply water contains chlorinated water, then what you can do is leave it in an open bucket overnight, and then the next day you can use it. Next is a sprayer. If you have a large collection outdoors, or if you have a greenhouse, then you can simply use your garden hose to water your orchids. But if you have some orchids in the balcony or indoors, then you will need a sprayer like this. Also, not only for watering the roots, but also for foliar spraying of the fertilizers, then we will need a sprayer of this sort. So when you are using your garden hose, in a very short amount of time, like in few seconds, the whole media, the whole orchid, it will get dripping wet. But when using a sprayer, you can spray your orchids in a quite controlled manner. You can adjust the jet. So when you are starting with your orchid, when you are new to it, then it's better to be able to water your orchid in a controlled manner. This sprayer, it comes around I think 180 to 200 rupees. It will depend. If you are ordering online, it will be slightly costlier, and if you are getting it from your local garden center, then it will come around I think 170-180 rupees. And of course you won't need one if you are watering by showing your orchid under running tap water, or if you are watering by soaking method. Another important thing to own is cutting tools. Use my kitchen knife and scissors, but each time I use them, I sterilize them, and before I use on different plants, or in fact if I am using even on the same plant, when I switch between the leaves or the canes, then I make sure that I sterilize them. The only intention of sterilizing is to avoid the spreading of infection. If at all there is an infection, then it won't spread from unhealthy tissue to other healthy tissue. You can sterilize them by different methods, by torching them, by showing them over your stove flame, or simply by wiping or spraying disinfectant or rubbing alcohol or sanitizer. So coming to other chemicals and fertilizers that we need is, if possible, then keep a bottle of 3% solution of hydrogen peroxide. It comes very cheap at the local chemist. This will come handy in extreme cases of root rot, crown rot. So one more thing that I always keep for my orchids is cinnamon. Always keep some powdered cinnamon ready for your orchids, be it any leaf or cane that you cut suspecting any infection. Simply dab a little cinnamon there on the cut ends. It acts as a desiccant, it will dry the wound, and also act as a fungicide. Even for
normally if you are removing spikes or if you are removing any dead leaves, then also you can just sprinkle or dab a little cinnamon. This will prevent infections from happening. So last but not the least, we come to fertilizers. The orchids can attach their roots to various surfaces like trees and all, but they are not parasites. They don't derive any nutrition from them. When we are growing orchids, we need to provide them nutrition in some form or the other. You can try various homemade organic food, but by this method we don't know exactly what and how much we are feeding. I use liquid seaweed extract on all my orchids all year round. It's not cheap, but one bottle it lasts for a couple of years. Earlier it used to cost 250 ml, it used to cost around 262 rupees, and now it has, the price has increased to 300 rupees. But the concentration also has increased. Like earlier the label used to say to use 5 ml per liter of water, but now it says just 1 to 3 ml per liter of water. So they have increased the concentration, and this little bottle is going to last for about a couple of years in my case. I also add a little like 1 teaspoon of Epsom salt to my seaweed fertilizer. I simply mix these in water and spray the orchids thoroughly, the root portion, the leaves and everything. And I do this every 15 to 20 days all year round, except for the winters, when in general I reduce fertilizing and watering my orchids. The seaweed fertilizer, it contains various plant growth hormones like cytokinins, gibberellins, and these help in promoting new growths and roots. And also it contains all macro and micronutrients and amino acids. It has NPK for overall growth of the plants. All these from natural sources. I am simply in love with it, and even if you add a bit excess, then there is hardly any risk of leaf or root tip burn. You can use any brand, just follow the label instructions. Start by using a weaker concentration, and you can then shift to recommended dose once you see the plants are tolerating the weaker concentration well. Instead of seaweed, you can also use a balanced fertilizer like NPK 20-20-20 during the active growth phase for promoting growth. Bloom boosters like NPK 8-25-25 or 14-35-14 to promote the blooms. Now you can use 2 cycles of growth promoter NPK and then 1 cycle of bloom booster NPK. And some people, they even alternate between the two, like 1 cycle of growth promoter and 1 cycle of bloom booster. I have stopped using NPK for I think past 3-4 years, so I can't tell much about it. It was very confusing for me, and as a beginner I messed up with my plants a lot by over fertilizing. So I stopped that, and I have been using seaweed for 4 years now, and the results are equally good. So yes, you need to use one or the other fertilizer for your orchids to keep them strong, healthy and to build up their immunity. Now some other small things that you may need are these twist ties, which they come in very handy while you tie a orchid to a stake, or maybe while staking a spike, but it's not absolute necessity. You can use twine in or even a ribbon instead of these. Next are these plant tags. These usually come with the orchids when we purchase them, and if not, then you can always make these from old files or folders, the plastic covers. You can cut and simply write with a permanent marker, or else you can buy them. So most of the things can be crafted, can be built or made suiting to our environment, to our style and our preference, and of course our budget. I really hope I could give at least some overview about the basic materials that we need to have when we start our orchid hobby. I hope you like today's video, and if you do, then please like, share and subscribe. Press on the bell icon to get notified each time I upload a new video. Thanks for watching. Bye bye.